first Christmas Eve that he was invited to dine with the McClarys. It was a bitterly cold night. After a busy day of cuts of ham, roast, chicken, and turkey, he was working late to clean his butcher block tables and knives. Brown had also worked late and only now, just paid, could afford a nice cut of meat for Christmas Eve. Brown and Nellie were frequent patrons of the butcher shop, but usually they asked for cheap cuts or ham bones, excused as just to flavor the beans. Aaron admired them both as he had accounted them to be hardworking, honest, and unpretentious. Noting that Aaron should be hurrying home dinner on that Christmas Eve, Brown inquired, and learned that Aaron had no family in the New World. His late uncle, a widower, had sponsored his Atlantic voyage and his shop startup. Aaron, previously apprenticed as a butcher in his Scotland homeland, he knew the trade well. Brown was quick to invite Aaron to join him and his family for supper that very special evening. He was so genuinely sincere and stubbornly insistent that Aaron could not refuse. Besides, Brown argued, the Scots and Irish are cousins, and it would not be Christian to allow a worthy kinsman to spend Christmas Eve alone. That evening at the McClary's, Aaron felt warmed, his body to the depth of his bones, and his soul to the height of its intended glory. Nellie prepared such a delightfully tasty meal that he felt compelled to praise the most delicious meal I have enjoyed since I departed my family's comfortable little cottage in the Highland Valley of the Glencoe. Aaron's memory of that Christmas Eve was enhanced by the candlelight of the dinner table. It glowed across Nellie's cheeks and flickered in her emerald eyes. He saw, in those eyes, the love she felt for her husband and their children. Curious to Aaron, that soothed his feelings, although he was uncertain of the nature of the affection he felt for Nellie, the wife of his newfound friend. He denied himself to ponder the question or to explore any circumstance of such daydreams. There was so much love in that family that he was fulfilled by simply absorbing the overflow from his peripheral vantage, like the warmth of a stove that floods through the open doorway of an adjoining room. That Christmas Eve, Brown had banked the stove with hard anthracite coal. Its warmth permeated to every corner of the three-room apartment. Brown's Irish coffee warmed the three adults from tongue to belly. Young Brianna, sporting a long braid of sandy gold hair from behind each ear, politely sat pretty and prim. She did not speak, but contributed much to the interest of the conversation with infinite expressions of smiles, bright eyes opening quickly in amusement, gasps of disbelief, and the most cheerful chuckles Aaron had heard since he last frolicked with his young cousins so many miles and years away in his beloved Scotland. Nellie rocked infant Ardle while she and Brown told of delightful days, hilarious incidents, and macabre tales of folklore. Aaron remained totally absorbed, listening intently and laughing spontaneously, only to find himself embarrassed by his hearty barking and by the tears of excessive laughter dripping down his cheeks. And moments later he would again find himself uncontrollably laughing until he would bark a nasal snort like a boar hog or, to his further embarrassment, thunderously pass wind, setting the group into yet another renewed round of laughter. Aaron would never forget the pleasures and comforts of that night, and every Christmas Eve that followed, as Brown steadily improved his station in life, and Nellie finally acquired a matching set of china and a more spacious home.